ओम ज्ञातिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकाय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमः ओम विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामी इति नामिने। नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे रामा राम राम हरे हरे, हरे कृष्णा। So today I'll continue our discussion on the appreciating Lord Nityananda, how he compliments Lord Chaitanya, and they both manifest the conservative liberal dance at the heart of our tradition. So in that connection, I'll do a quick recap of what we discussed yesterday. I started by talking about how in every tradition there are conservatives and liberals. So the conservatives connect the tradition with the past through fidelity or through faithfulness, and the liberals connect the tradition with the present through resourcefulness or flexibility. And while Lord Chaitanya is the supremely merciful incarnation, simultaneously he is very devotionally magnanimous, but he was culturally conservative in many ways. So his actions were primarily oriented toward reaching out in a respectable way to those who were following the Vedic tradition. So whether it was the sannyasis in Varanasi, to whom he tried to reach out by ensuring that he followed that he was not flouting their expectations of how a sannyasi should live, where a sannyasi should eat. And like that, he in some ways was culturally conservative. And Chaitanya Prabhu is culturally liberal, we could say. He was a avdhut, a form of sannyasi. And he left to practice his service to Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu by reaching out to people who were left out of the Vedic fold, whether they be the thieves or whether they be people like Jagai and Madai. And we see that he, in reaching out to people like Jagai and Madai, it was risky for him. And so being liberal is not just about being loose. It's also about being courageous. It's about being heroically courageous to take Krishna's message to places where it would not otherwise go. Of course, everywhere there is danger in the world. And yes, in being liberal, there is a danger. But in being conservative also, there is a danger. Now we see how one of the most damaging deviations for the Vedic tradition has come from within the Vedic tradition itself. That is the caste system. So alertness is required whether we are conservative or whether we are liberals. So today I'll talk about how this particular theme of conservative and liberal is seen within the most celebrated pastime of Lord Nityananda, and that is the deliverance of Jagai and Madai. So the very desire of Lord Nityananda to deliver Jagai and Madai indicates his desire to serve Lord Chaitanya. And not only serve Lord Chaitanya in ways that are normally not done, and they were normally not even considered doable. We know famously how Prabhupada tried to go to America, and he went after long efforts. And many of his godbrothers, many of them were also very devoted, they were also very learned, they were also very renounced. But somehow they felt that Western people would never become devotees. And that's where the issue ended. But Prabhupada wanted to reach out to those people. And that's how he was very, in one sense, well, we may sometimes think of Prabhupada as conservative. Yes, he was conservative in some ways, but he was also very accommodating. The word liberal might have a negative connotation, so we can use the word accommodating or very inclusive in other ways. We know that he stayed at the Mishra Yoga studio, and this Mishra was a Mayavadi. He wouldn't let Prabhupada speak. So, because Prabhupada would refute his Mayavad, and then he would let Prabhupada only do kirtans. And when Prabhupada got an opportunity to serve Krishna, he immediately left from there and he went to the Lower East Side. But Prabhupada did not hold any negativity or resentment toward Mishra. So later on, almost a decade or so later, both of them met, and Giriraj Maharaj mentions this pastime that he says that, you know, they had a very cordial and warm talk. And he's a little surprised. Isn't he a Mayavadi? That was the question in his mind. And Prabhupada said, yes. Just philosophically, we argue like anything. But culturally, we are friends. So people are not just philosophical creatures. We cannot reduce them to a philosophical designation. People are multidimensional. And culturally, they found some similarity. Prabhupada was courteous. And they connected at that level. So similarly, what happened that Prabhupada did not see the Western people simply as fallen. Yes, they were fallen, but Prabhupada also saw them as having a spark of spirituality, having some potential he detected in their searching through drugs, in their search through rebellion, through the counterculture. They had some spark. So similarly, Nityanand Prabhu saw some spark. Now, the story of Jagai and Madha is also poignant because it is said that they were born in Brahminical families. And they were Jagadananda and Madhavananda. And both of them fell away. Now, how exactly did they fall away? What exactly happened? It is said that by bad association, they fell away. And they fell away to such an extent that they themselves became the worst bad association eventually. And as they were living like this, nobody would want to be with them, but Nityananda Prabhu thought, let me deliver them. And the second time, if they went again. Now, when they went again, what happened at that time? When he went again, so this time Jagai and Madai tried to attack. They both got angry and they both tried to attack Lord Nityananda. And at that time, When they actually not only tried to attack, they attacked Lord Nityananda. And when they attacked Lord Nityananda, so what happened at that time? At that time, he started bleeding. It was not just a small blow. It was a big, heavy pot, which was in the beginning. It was so close to him, they hurled the pot at his head. And his whole head started bleeding and his body was not just smeared, but his upper cloth, his body was drenched with blood. It was a severe blow. And at that time, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu heard that, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came there. Furious, he had a Sudarshan Chakra. I said, Vishnu, Vishnu, and Chakra, Chakra. And he wanted to lop off the head of Jagai and Madai. What did Nityananda Prabhu do at that time? He intervened. And he said, my dear Lord, now if ever I have done any piety, then please, you give me some reward in exchange for that. And the reward I seek is, I want the charity that you give me the body of these two people. Please don't punish them. So they had wounded him, leave alone wanting to wound them back. He didn't even want somebody else to wound them. He didn't even want the Lord to wound them. Now, when he stopped the Lord's wrath from coming on them, was he opposing the Lord? No, he was not opposing the Lord. Externally, he was stopping the Lord from doing something. But internally, what was the mood? He was actually fulfilling the Lord's mission. You see, Lord Chaitanya has this dynamic mood. At one level, he wants to uphold the principles of dharma. There is upholding of dharma and there is transcending of dharma. So sometimes in upholding the principles of dharma, by dharma we can mean duty, rules, activities which are righteous. Dharma can have many different meanings. One meaning, of course, is that it refers to innate nature, but also refers to many other things. So when he's upholding dharma, he wants to set a very strong example of what is to be done. But there's another side of him, that compassion ultimately transcends dharma. Or we could say compassion is the highest dharma, but sometimes in the process of following rules and pursuing rules, principles of dharma might get obscured. So we could say that rules are like roads, and principles are like the direction. So if you want to go in a particular direction, the rules are often the best way to go in that direction. But still, it may happen sometimes that the road is blocked. And the road is blocked, then if you want to go in that direction, then we may have to leave the road and then to find some other way to go in that direction. So unless we understand this principle, that for each one of us, ultimately it is the direction that is important. So now at one level, it is Lord Chaitanya is being entirely right. He's being right in saying that actually, if anybody is doing wrong, they need to be punished. But at the same time, in this case, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Nityananda, both of them are working together. And at one level, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is following the letter of the law. You are such a grievous attacker to my devotee, I will punish you. But ultimately, Lord Chaitanya is the merciful avatar. He's supremely merciful. So what he does is, he is manifesting that mood of compassion through Nityananda Prabhu. So Nityananda Prabhu is not acting opposite to Lord Chaitanya. Lord Chaitanya is setting one example, and he also wants the other example to be set. So in this sense, we could say Lord Chaitanya is being strict. He is being conservative. That he is, this is, you did this, this is the rule. Throw the rule book at the person. You have to be punished. And that is required. The wrongdoers need to be punished. Otherwise, society will, there will be chaos in society. At the same time, along with justice, there is a principle of compassion. So Nityananda Prabhu is manifesting the principle of compassion over here. And both of them are working together. And they're both working for the same purpose. The purpose is to deliver, not just specifically Jagannath and Madai, but to deliver a message to the world. So though we cannot very easily get away after injuring devotees, there can be serious consequences. But Nityananda Prabhu is so merciful that when he intervenes, he's intervening out of compassion. And that compassionate intervention actually is fulfilling the purpose of Lord Chaitanya. So we see this similar point elsewhere when Balabhadra Bhattacharya, he is Lord Chaitanya's servant, and while he is being servant of Lord Chaitanya, he gets diverted by the Bhattaharis. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is very upset by that. And when he is upset by that, what does he do? He still keeps him by his side, but when he comes back and just, with great displeasure, he says, this is your servant, this is what he did, this is the person you had sent with me, just see what he did. And he just, in one sense, rejects him. But although he rejects him, what do the devotees do? The devotees are kind to him, devotees are compassionate to him. And what is the way they show the compassion? They show the compassion by giving him some other service. Now, from the point of view of rules, yes, the rules have to be followed. But at the same time, and if somebody slips from the rules, we don't want everybody to start taking rules casually, nonchalantly. But we don't want the rules to become obstacles for people to come to Krishna. So that means that in that case, in that situation, the devotees show compassion, and among those devotees, Nityananda Prabhu is also there. Say, okay, you go to Sachimata, you go to Mayapur and tell them about the pastimes of Lord Chaitanya. And in that way, what happens is, here he feels I am rejected by the Lord. What is my value? What can I do? But from that situation of being rejected by the Lord, he's now put in a situation where He's welcome. Oh, you are going to tell us Lord Chaitanya's pastimes. Welcome, welcome, welcome. So this is how the devotees ensure that even Balabhadra Bhattacharya feels valued. So here there's an important point that everybody needs to feel valued. Not valued at the same level, because different people are at different levels of spiritual advancement. But if being conservative makes us devalue people, that is undesirable. And if being liberal makes us devalue rules, that is also undesirable. So let's look at a diagram over here to understand this principle. Here there's the four quadrants. We can say this is about, you know, if we consider there is letter of the law and there is spirit of the law. Now, if one cares neither for the letter of the law nor the spirit of the law, then that person is being whimsical. That is undesirable. That is very, that will not take us anywhere. Now, I'm the conservatives, the letter of the law is important. Now, that doesn't mean the spirit of the law is not important for them, but the letter of the law is important. This is how things went. The words liberals and conservatives have certain connotations, so it's just a limitation of language. But the point is that sometimes in the name of giving importance to the spirit of the law, we might neglect the law completely. So we could say if somebody goes too much in the conservative direction, here at the bottom, at the light bottom, there'll be fanaticism. At the left bottom, at the left top, there'll be relativism. That means if you become too liberal, oh, this is your way, that is your way, then everything is yathomat tathopat. It will become like that. And that is undesirable. But if you become too conservative, then what will happen is, then we'll go to a direction of fanatical. And those who don't, remember what I said, that liberals are those who stay connect the living tradition with the contemporary world. And the conservatives are those who connect the living tradition with the past. And both connections are required. And when both connections are strong, there is high regard for the letter of the law and there's high regard for the spirit of the law. That's when it's most effective. That's when it's most effective. So now Niyamagraha, we know this concept in the Bhakti Rasamrita, in the Upadeshamrita. And Niyamagraha can happen from both sides. If we stick only to the letter of the law and neglect the spirit of the law, that is Niyamagraha. But if we neglect both the letter and the spirit of the law, and then that can also lead to Niyamagraha. So overall, the principle is that Lord Chaitanya, he, in a devotional sense, he breaks all barriers and gives the mercy to everyone. But in a cultural sense, he is conservative. Nityanand Prabhu, he takes that same mood of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and he breaks cultural barriers. And by breaking cultural barriers, he reaches out to people who would otherwise not be reached out to. Nityanand Prabhu is known as an avdhut. Now, the word avdhut has a specific meaning, that it refers to one who is beyond the rules. It is beyond the rules because they need more than it's not that they reject the rules, but they transcend the rules. They don't need the rules. If somebody is a seasoned traveler, if they have gone in a particular direction hundreds of times, then even if there's no road, they know which direction to go to. So for most people, the safest way to go in the right direction is to go by the rules. But sometimes the rules may block the way for some people. Sometimes, so then for them, okay, if you find some way, even if the rules are not working, find some way to keep them moving forward. So Nityananda Prabhu manifests that magnanimity of Lord Chaitanya in a particularly in a remarkably inclusive way. Now Nityananda Prabhu, if you look at his overall life, we'll see some themes that it is said that he's the first class servant of Lord Chaitanya. And the first class servant of Lord Chaitanya means that he is giving Lord Chaitanya he knows the mind of Lord Chaitanya. I mean, because he knows the mind of Lord Chaitanya, so what happens? So, because he knows the mind of Lord Chaitanya, he can fulfill the Lord mind of Lord Chaitanya even if he goes against the word of Lord Chaitanya. So the mind of Lord Chaitanya is that everybody should be delivered, and the word of Lord Chaitanya is, for example, somewhat different. So Lord Chaitanya also wants Jagai and Madai to be delivered, but the way he does it is in a different way. He talks about Anjani, the principle of dharma also, and that is shown by Lord Nityananda. So what I mentioned, this is a simple PowerPoint what I discussed till now. I will move forward from here. The role of rules in bhakti, we see the rules as showing the way. This is the way, that is the conservative understanding. But sometimes the rules block the way. If the rules block the way, what do we do? Then that's when we need to be liberal. I mentioned yesterday about Srila Prabhupada. When he came to America, he wanted to have a center. And he wanted funds to build a center. But they didn't have funds. There was a wealthy Indian businessman, Padampat Singhania, who was interested in having a temple built in America. But at that time, the Indian government's rules about foreign exchange were very, very strict. And it would not let money go out of India. So Prabhupada tried very much to request the Indian government, but it didn't work. Prabhupada asked his godbrothers to go. Some of his godbrothers were quite influential. They knew the heads of state, some high ups in the Indian government. He asked them to help, but they didn't help. And Prabhupada planned that Lal Bahadur Shastri was supposed to, he was the Prime Minister of India at that time. He was going to go to Moscow and then come to America. Prabhupada had hope that he will be able to meet him during the American visit and request him to release foreign exchange. But then what happened? Lal Bahadur Shastri unfortunately died in Moscow. And then Prabhupada wrote to Padampat Singhania. He said that, you know, ultimately we want to glorify Krishna. Prabhupada spoke in a very beautiful way. He says, you have the mood of Dwarka and I have the mood of Vrindavan, but we are all glorifying Krishna. So in Vrindavan, Krishna is worshipped simply. So let's worship Krishna simply. You just send me some funds and I will start something over here. And then eventually we can build a temple as more funds come. So, but unfortunately, Padampat Singhania said, he was too conservative. He said, if I want a temple, the temple has to be proper architecture, proper spire. Otherwise, I don't want to contribute. And then, so here, it is Prabhupada is a pure devotee. He is being liberal. And somebody is a pious Hindu. They're thinking, what is the use of building a temple if you don't have the proper architecture? And then what is happening? What is normally the way is blocking the way. So Prabhupada decided to start with a storefront. I said, now in the case of Avadhutas, the rules are no longer needed to see the way. That is the Avadhutas. So this is broadly, now Chaitanya Nityananda Prabhu acts at the Avadhuta level, and sometimes he acts at this level also, where if the rule is blocking the way, the rule is you offend a devotee, you will be punished. But Nityananda Prabhu says, no, I don't want them to be punished, my dear Lord. Please, please, for my sake, forgive them. So what is he doing? He's extending the mercy beyond the rule of the law, beyond the letter of the law, to the spirit of the law. So as I said, roads are the rules, and the direction in which you are going, the direction is the principle. So we need to acknowledge the rule, but also focus on the principle. So niyamagraha can happen in two ways. Insist on the rules at the cost of the principles, or neglect both the rules and the principles. And both Gaur and Nithai, we are going to talk about the dance that is the liberal conservative dance that is the heart of our tradition. So Gaur and Nithai work together, and how there are two different forms of mercy. Lord Chaitanya's mercy is at one level, he wants to punish the offender and he wants to protect the offender. Now we may say, what is the mercy in punishing the offender? Well, there is something over there. If you consider, some people are lifted by the rules and some people are left out by the rules. So everybody needs to be elevated. Everybody needs to be elevated. And how does one elevate everyone? By knowing what to offer when. So for somebody who has the capacity to follow rules and thereby grow, there is no need to be liberal with them. And for them, be conservative. For those who are in a situation where the rules will just leave them out, then be liberal. So Nityananda Prabhu manifests this mercy of Lord Chaitanya by reaching out to people who would be left out by the instead of similar rule. When Srila Prabhupada was in America, there were devotees who joined him, and although they were culturally the way they had been brought and brought up was very far away from the Vedic standard. But they developed faith in Prabhupada and surrendered their life to Prabhupada. And in that way, they were attracted and they were elevated. And they followed Krishna consciousness very seriously. So for them, it was Krishna consciousness was almost like 1-0. If you're outside in the material world, you are materialists. But if you're inside the temple, then you're wearing robes and having the full morning program and going out and doing missionary work. That you are a devotee. That was their conception. Now, when Prabhupada came back to India, at that time, it created a sensation to see this Western people wearing Indian dress and following Indian culture. And Indians were astonished and delighted and almost proud of it. They're proud of their own culture and they were very appreciative and admiring of Srila Prabhupada. But still, they didn't become devotees. You see, among Srila Prabhupada's disciples who became disciples, many became life members and many helped in a very big ways to build various temples. So now, Prabhupada with the life members was liberal. So Prabhupada manifested in some places the mood of Lord Chaitanya, some places the mood of Lord Nityananda. So in some places, this is the rules and you have to follow the rules. But for the life members, you know, it was not that every life member's house he went, he insisted you had to chant 16 rounds and you had to follow four regs. Many of them were of course following the four regs. But he didn't insist to them in every class to Indians, you should chant 16 rounds. Now Prabhupada saw what was their interest. Many of Prabhupada's talks in India are in one sense appealing to the cultural nationalistic feelings of Indians. Prabhupada says, for example, in lecture that Bhagavad Gita is a book from India. And to teach the Bhagavad Gita in India, I have to bring people from abroad. He says, why don't you study the Gita and teach the Gita? You can teach it all over the world. So now at one level, the Bhagavad Gita is not Indian. The Bhagavad Gita says even we are not Indians. No, we don't belong to any particular nationality. Prabhupada knew that. So first, Prabhupada still engaged them. Now he had them contribute to building the temples. He had them become life members. And he engaged them at the level that they were at. Many of them were already following many other spiritual teachers, worshipping various other devtas. And Prabhupada didn't condemn them for that. Prabhupada just engaged them in service. Giriraj Maharaj was extensively with Prabhupada during those times. I asked Maharaj, and then Prabhupada visited the house of Indian life members. They probably had their own altars with various objects on their altar with various pictures or various duties. So did Prabhupada question or criticize? He says, I don't remember a single incident when Prabhupada did that. So Prabhupada saw, okay, what can I do for these people? They have some cultural piety. Let me engage them in service. So Prabhupada gave them they became life members, Prabhupada gave them the books. And in the books, he did give them the full, which person when. So it's not so much about conservative and liberal are just terms. The ultimate principle is that we want to rise ourselves and we want to raise others. And the way to do that is by doing what is required for the other person to rise. And that was the mood of Lord Nityananda. Wherever he went. Now, why did he wear such opulent clothes? Because that would attract thieves. Now, why did he behave in an avdhut way? Now, that was just to... when he behaved in such an avdhut way, it was the people who were normally following strict rules, they were perturbed by that. But just as we have the example of Lord Shiva is called as Bhutanath. Bhutanath means that he is especially compassionate to those who are in the mode of ignorance. So, to the Bhutas and Pretas. Similarly, Nityananda Prabhu, he behaved in an extraordinary way, dressed himself in an extraordinary way. We were surprised, intrigued. What is this? Who is this? Is this person supposed to be a saintly person? What is he doing? And he attracted them. So, Nityananda Prabhu is extraordinarily merciful. And I'll quickly mention the outline of this pastime of thieves. And we will conclude with that and we can have a few questions. So, while Nityananda Prabhu was residing in magnificence, in glory. He had royal magnificence, regal glory. He had regal opulence he was exhibiting that attracted this group of thieves. And they decided that, who is this person? You know, we will rob him. We can, with one robbery, वी कैन गेट मोर देन इनफ फॉर आवर एंटायर लाइफ टाइम, सो लेट्स डू दैट. दे केम वन नाइट एंड देन दे सॉ देयर वर जायंट पीपल, जायंट गार्ड्स ओवर देयर. दे सेड यू नो वी आर थीव्स, वी आर हूलिगन्स, वी आर टफ पीपल. बट एंड व्हेन दे केम बैक समहाउ यू नो दिस हैपेंड फॉर वन डे, टू डे, थ्री डेज. And what are the Tantru doing? The Tantru could have straight delivered them, condemned them. He could have done them anything in one day itself. But in time, Prabhu was purifying them by his remembrance. You know, because they were thinking, oh, when will we go to that person? When will we rob? When will we get his jewels? When will we get these from him? So what happened by that is that they were thinking about him more and more and more and more. And as thinking about more and more, it is, as I said, the seventh canto of the Bhagavatam is quite clear that however we remember Krishna, it's purifying. Gopya kama bhayat kumso dvesha chaidya adayandrupa. So the gopis, some of the gopis remember Krishna out of pure love, but some of the gopis were not yet purified. They were attracted to Krishna by kama, just like a girl might be attracted toward a boy. Bhayat kumso. The kumsa was outside, attracted out of fear. Without attracted, he was meditating on Krishna, constantly meditating on Krishna out of fear. So we could say that then Chaitya Shishupal was meditating out of envy. So we could add to that list, you know, Stena Lobhat, that these thieves, they were meditating on the Lord. That meditation was purifying them. That meditation was purifying them. And one day, they went and they were blocked by the guard. Another day they went and they found the devotees are doing kirtan. And the kirtan was just going on and on and on and on. They're wondering, when will it end? They just waited and waited and waited and then dozed off. And then when they woke up, by the time it was all daytime, and they had all these weapons and everything, they immediately hid all the weapons and they went away. And they thought, oh, we didn't worship the goddess properly. So we see in the Vedic context that even those who were, like we have demons, even Kamsa would worship the goddess. So even that these people who are wrongdoers also sometimes gain power by the higher beings. They think of appeasing the higher beings. So they worship the goddess and they went back. And they thought, with the goddess blessings, we will be successful today. And the goddess really blessed them and they were really successful. But the way they were successful was to be strong. And the thunderbolt and the rains, and there seemed to be snow pebbles coming, there should be sheet coming down, sleet coming down, and what's happening over here? And then it seemed as if they became blinded and they fell into a ditch and they didn't know what to do. And in that situation, the leader of the thieves started thinking, we have done so many robberies, they never faced a problem like this. What is this? Thinking, maybe this Nityananda is really God. Otherwise, how could we have been thwarted so many times? And thinking like this, he prayed, oh Nityananda, please forgive me, please deliver me. And then what happened? As soon as he said that, then the storm disappeared and his eyes came back. And then he just told, ordered all his associates, and he got up and he went in. And the devotees, some of the devotees were apprehensive. Who's this hefty looking, menacing looking person coming into the kirtan? This person coming to disrupt things. And that person came in and he just came straight to Lord Nityananda. The devotee wondering, how will he stop him also if he tries to attack? Will Nityananda have to exhibit some miracles? He just came and offered straight dandavat pranam to Lord Nityananda. And he surrendered his life to him. And when he surrendered his life to Lord Nityananda, Nityananda embraced him and blessed him with Nityananda. He filled him with eternal bliss of love for Krishna, love for Lord Chaitanya, love of God. And then he became so transformed by this, that he set about a mission that Nityananda is so merciful, I have to give his mercy to others. And he started going around and giving that mercy to various things. And Nityananda Prabhu would travel across, he would go to Bengal and Orissa at that time. Wherever he would be having satsang program, suddenly the devotees would be sitting and hearing katha, and sometimes what would happen is, suddenly a group of threatening looking people would come in. And those people would not know, because it's a new crowd, and one says, you're going to a new place. Like, hey, what are these? And they would come, and this thief who had become a preacher now, they would all come and surrender to Nityananda. And this way Nityananda reached out to people. So now what he did was, somehow or the other, yena prakarena mana krishna niveshayet. This is not just a principle for us. We have to remember Krishna. It's also a principle about how we are to engage others. Somehow or the other, get people to think of Krishna, get them to raise their consciousness. So Nityananda Prabhu, by wearing these expensive clothes and ornaments, he attracted the thieves' attention and he got him to think of Krishna. And you see, Srila Prabhupada also did that same thing. There is a story of how Srila Prabhupada would sometimes be given very expensive gifts. And Prabhupada was very unattached, but because the gift was given, he would accept it. So one time somebody gave Prabhupada a very expensive, like a Rolex watch, and he was wearing this. And there was one person in India, he was a thief. And he somehow met some devotees, he saw BTG magazine, Prabhupada was wearing this watch. He said, oh, this Swami has this watch. He says, maybe if I can meet this Swami, I'll steal this watch from him. And then he investigated about, and he was in the Mumbai area. So he came to the there's a Juhu temple. So he went to the temple and he asked, where is this Swami? He says, he's not here, but he'll come in future. So he seemed interested. The devotees were very short, very much lacking in manpower. They said, now if you want to, you can stay here and you can do some service. I said, fine. He started staying there, and following the rules as much as he could. And then he was waiting. Somehow Prabhupada attracted him. Now he had an ulterior motive. But he was eager for Prabhupada. When is Prabhupada going to come? When is Prabhupada going to come? So on one level, he was thinking about Prabhupada, thinking about Prabhupada. At the same time, what was happening? He was with the devotees who were loving Prabhupada. He was serving Krishna. He was in various ways connecting, and that was purifying him. And when he finally met Prabhupada, what happened was, when he went into Prabhupada's room, the Prabhupada saw him, and on his own, Prabhupada took out his Rolex watch and gave it to him. And he was stunned. How did you know? He just didn't know what to say at that time. And then, all the things he had heard about Prabhupada, how he's such a great devotee, because he was a thief, he had not cared at that time. But because of this, what happened is, he was so impressed. He said, this Swami must be like a very, very bold person. How did he nonchalantly giving up this watch and giving it to him? And he had heard from other devotees while he was in the ashram. Many of those devotees were from well-to-do families. Giriraj Maharaj himself was from a very well-to-do family. He left it all and come. So all that, in that one gesture of Prabhupada, all that he had experienced and heard during the last several weeks, it all came together in one bolt of lightning. What happened is, Prabhupada, I don't want this. I want to serve you. I want to serve you. On TV, now we have, of course, ISKCON Desire and Hare Krishna TV is very big. But almost two decades before, he was the person who started ISKCON TV, ITV as we call it. And then we had the Atma serial where Gaurang Prabhu and other devotees were on TV speaking about the Bhagavad Gita. So what happened is that Prabhupada, he didn't have to wear an expensive watch. But Prabhupada, he adopted certain things so that he could attract certain people. So a devotee is expert. So we can conclude this point that the importance is not being liberal, not being conservative. It is being daksha. It is being expert. One of the qualities of a devotee is daksha. A devotee is expert to attract people to Krishna by doing whatever is necessary. We know in Singapore, Prabhupada was in the Hilton Hotel and some journalists came to him and they said, Swamiji, you are supposed to be renunciate. Why are you staying in this Hilton Hotel? And Prabhupada said, I can live under a tree. But if I had lived under a tree, would you have come to interview me? And that reporter fell silent. So compassion is a very lofty value. And we all want to internalize the value or the virtue of compassion within us. But how compassion translates in our day-to-day life, in our actions, is through expertise. Expertise means we don't see Krishna consciousness as simply a set of rule books. Krishna consciousness is not just simply like having a formula and memorizing a set of statements and speaking them out to others. So what expertise means, where is this person? What is the spark that I can fan in this person? By that they can take a step toward Krishna. And when we have that mood, we find that there are so many people whom we thought that they are never going to become Krishna conscious. Yeah, they may not become Krishna conscious in a particular sense. But maybe their consciousness can move one step upward toward Krishna. And we can become an instrument in that. So the way Nityanand Prabhu radically transformed Jagai and Madai from people whom who, on seeing them, people would run away and take bath in the Ganga. Two, they became so purified that when people saw them, they thought that they have bathed in the Ganga. Now, that level of transformation, we may not be able to bring about in anyone. That requires an extraordinary level of purity and potency. But the principle of compassion is, wherever a person is, how can I help them rise? It may be by giving them books. It may be by inviting them to a temple. It may be by just speaking a kind word to them. It may be just by establishing a human connection with them that they feel, oh, this devotee is a nice person. And that agyat sukriti, our behaving in such a way by which that they appreciate a devotee, that is also a way in which we are helping them grow. So we can all pray to Nityananda Prabhu that the extraordinary, radical, revolutionary compassion that he manifested, that we become both the objects and the instruments of that compassion. The objects of that compassion means that by that compassion, our consciousness becomes elevated and attracted toward Krishna, and that we become instruments of that compassion, by which, you know, we can share whatever way the Lord wants us to share Krishna's mercy, help people to take one step forward at least in their journey toward Krishna. So, Shri Nityananda Prabhu ki jai. Shri Nityananda Trayodashi Mahamahotsav ki jai. So, I'll quickly summarize, and if you have a question, you can take. So, I spoke three main points today. First of all, I started by talking about how Lord Chaitanya Nityananda manifest mercy, the same mercy, in two different ways. One is, mercy can be manifested to some people by providing them the rules by which they can rise upward. So rules are like the road by which, that is a time-tested way to move in the desired direction. But for some people, the rules may not be possible. The road is blocked for them. So then for them, we have to show them another way. And that is what Nityananda Prabhu does. So if you are attacking a devotee, you need to be punished. That's the rule. And that's what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was doing. But that same Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mercy was manifested to Nityananda Prabhu by, oh no, my dear Lord, please forgive them. So mercy can have many different manifestations. And then, so I talked about Niyamagraha in terms of how there is letter of the law is important, the spirit of the law is important. So the conservatives are more concerned about letter of the law, and liberals are concerned more about the spirit of the law. And when both of them come together, the shared concern can make a tradition extremely effective. And then I concluded by talking about the thieves pastime, where Nityananda Prabhu, he orchestrated this whole leela. First, he dressed in a very opulent way, and then through various days and various obstacles that those thieves met in their attempting to rob Lord Nityananda, what happened is they're thinking about him, and that stena lobhat, by thinking about him in a mood of greed, they become purified. And we discussed about how Srila Prabhupada also manifested sometimes conservative, sometimes liberal. The point is not being conservative, being liberal, but being expert. Expert means this person in this situation, how can I help them come closer to Krishna? Sometimes we can help them go all the way to the Krishna. Sometimes they may just be able to take one step toward Krishna. So we can pray that Lord Chaitanya make us both the object and instrument of his compassion. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Krishna Prabhuji, koti koti dandavat pranam. That's such a blissful and ecstatic class, Prabhuji. Thank you very, very so much for sharing the wonderful realizations with us. The pastimes of Nityananda Prabhu and Srila Prabhupada. Thank you very so much. I now request devotees, please go ahead and unmute your microphones to share your realizations, or if you have any questions for Prabhuji at this time, please go ahead. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Dandavat Pranam.
Dandavat, Hare Krishna.
Prabhu, I'm speaking from Gurgaon.
Hare Krishna. Yes.
I have not been able to follow the role of rules in bhakti.
Okay. So, what is the role of rules in bhakti? Bhakti is essentially the redirection of our heart toward Krishna. We want to offer our heart to Krishna. Now, at the highest level, when we love someone, or when you want to love someone, what do? We do the things that please them. and we avoid doing the things that displease them. So yes. In bhakti, essentially rules are those two things itself. Now the rules of bhakti are of two kinds, prescriptions and proscriptions. What we should do and what we should not do. So the essentially the prescriptions are, we do the things that Krishna likes. And what are the things that Krishna likes? Krishna likes those things which connect us more with him, which help us to come closer to him, so that ultimately he can take us home to him eternally. So the prescriptive rules, do's in bhakti, are basically the things that Krishna likes us to do because they will bring us closer to him. And the don'ts in bhakti, the proscriptions, are essentially the things that take us away from Krishna, that disconnect us from Krishna, that infatuate our minds with many other things. So if you consider intoxication or unrestrained sexual activity or gambling, all these activities, what they do is they fill our mind with so many agitating stimuli that we can't go toward Krishna. So Krishna doesn't like it. Krishna is displeased when we turn away from him, because he loves us and he doesn't want us to languish and suffer in material existence for more than necessary. So basically, instead of seeing them simply as rules, we can see them simply, we can see them instead as essentially ways of developing a relationship with Krishna. So we do the things which Krishna likes and we avoid the things that Krishna doesn't like. Okay?
Prabhu, in relation to liberal and conservative, you had explained, which I could not follow.
No, I don't understand. What exactly? Because the whole class was about that. What exactly about it did you not follow?
In connection to conservatives and liberals. How does it imply?
Imply what?
You had shown some diagram, which I missed out.
Oh, okay. So
you had shown some diagram.
This one, isn't it?
As regards conservative and liberal.
These are the diagram. So liberals are more concerned with the spirit of the law. So spirit of the law means what? That if there is a particular rule, say for example, like I give the example, that temple architecture should be in a temple structure and architecture should be a particular way. So that's the rule of the law. But the spirit of the law is that ultimately God is to be glorified. The Lord is to be glorified. Any place where the Lord is glorified can be a temple. So the spirit of the law is more important than the letter of the law. That is the liberal mood. Now, I don't want to cast the conservatives in the negative light, but the point is that sometimes the letter of the law is also important. So what I said is that there's a letter of the law and there's a spirit of the law. So when there is a high regard for both of them, that's when things are effective. So there is a rule and then there is the purpose of the rule. So the rules are to be followed, just like we have traffic rules. And we can't break the speed limit. We can't break the signals. And it's important. For most people, following the traffic rules is important. But suppose there is an ambulance and a person is about to die. And ambulances, when they start honking, then everybody else stands by the way. And they can even break signals and go. So there are situations when, for ultimately, what is the purpose of traffic rules? It is to ensure smooth and safe travel. It is to ensure that people live and people flourish. People can do whatever they need to do in life. But if an ambulance, that's an emergency. So the rules can be suspended sometimes. So that's how the relationship between liberals and conservatives is. That what needs to be stressed when, that has to be understood. Is it clear now?
Yes, Prabhu. Thank you very much. Wonderful class, Prabhu.
Happy to be of service. Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna,
Prabhuji. Thank you so much for the session on 2 days. It's very, very clear. So Prabhuji, in practical sense for our day-to-day life, I want to ask like how to take this two approach. So as a neophyte, like when we start practicing, our focus is more on following rules so that we can become strong. And then, you know, we can, if we follow the rules, then we become strong. We don't, our mind don't get lax if we follow the rules. But in a family situation, not everybody at same level. So for others, like rules are, they are not following the rules. So we think that, okay, take a liberal approach and break the rules for them. But then my mind says that if I break the rules, then myself is not strong. So I may slip, I may fall as well. So how to balance that two approach in a day-to-day practical family life when not everybody at same level?
Okay, that's a very good question. So let me show you something here. Yeah. Can you see this diagram? So basically, we can see that we have, let me make it full screen. So there are three dynamics over here. There is Krishna, we are here, and then there are other person. So you can say the relationship. So there is our relationship with Krishna, there is our relationship with others, and there is their relationship with Krishna. So quite often what happens is when we are in a relationship with someone, we are very concerned about their relationship with Krishna. Are they practicing bhakti? At what standard they're practicing bhakti? And that is an important concern, no doubt. However, we need to be clear about the priority. See, our relationship with Krishna is the first and most important. The second is our relationship with them. And third is their relationship with Krishna. Why is that the third? Because everybody has free will. Even Krishna doesn't force anyone. So who are we to force? So usually in devotional context, most of the problems come because we force three on the other person too much.
Mm-hmm.
Do this, do this, do this. And when we force the three, that creates a strain in the two.
Mm-hmm.
When we try to push others to do more in Krishna Bhakti than what they are ready for, mm-hmm. then that creates a strain in our relationship with them.
Mm-hmm.
And when that strain is created in our relationship with them, then that strain affects our relationship with Krishna also.
Mm-hmm.
If there is constant tension or quarrels or harsh words being spoken, then we can't chant properly. We may sit and take the beads, but we can't chant.
Mm-hmm.
So what we need to do is stop pushing three too much.
Mm-hmm.
So stop pushing three. And ideally, we would like all three to go together.
Mm-hmm.
But in some situations, just separate the two. No, we maintain two at a human responsible level.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you are in a family, in a relationship, whatever is expected in that relationship at a functional level, at a proper dharmic level, we do that.
Mm-hmm.
And if we just do that, so if we give the other person their space, over a period of time, they will give us our space.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But what happens when we intrude into their space, then they will intrude into our space.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, in that sense, yes, if others are not following rules, then what do? We can't force them to follow rules,
mm-hmm.
but we can make it clear. These things are important for me and I'll do these things.
Mm-hmm.
We can just tell them that I'll be happy if you do it, but I won't force you.
Mm-hmm.
But when I am doing these things, please don't obstruct me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to stop you if there are some other things you want to do, and I won't stop you from that, but you please don't interfere.
Mm-hmm.
So once we can keep our one strong by separating the two and the three.
Uh-huh.
Sometimes you start thinking that, you know, if this person is not practicing bhakti, then why am I relating with that person?
Uh-huh.
No, sometimes some people, by their association, sometimes, you know, by their not being a devotee, we may actually learn more humility and tolerance and service attitude.
Uh-huh.
And that might help us grow in bhakti. So bhakti is not just simply externals. Yes, we would like them to also come to the temple. They also have to practice bhakti. But if that doesn't happen, we can separate the three and focus, make sure that one is taken care of. But we don't have to make one like dominate our entire life. We have time for our bhakti, have time for our satsang and seva and other things, satsang, seva, sadhana, whatever is there. But after that, you know, do the two as responsibly as we can. And quite often, if we are good in the two, you know, if we do our duties responsibly, and if they will see that, Oh, you know, you were so short-tempered earlier. Now you have become more patient. You have become calmer. And that, if the two improves, and they start feeling, how did this improve? That is because of one. Mm-hmm. That is because of your relationship with Krishna. And they will also be inspired to develop their relationship with Krishna.
Right.
So that's how we can maintain strictness with ourselves and at the same time be accommodating, lenient with others.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Thank you so much, Rahuji. Like it becomes so clear with this 1, 2, and 3 and the priority. Like I was always confused with this. So today you made it so simple and so clear. So thank you so much, Rahuji. Thank you.
Thank you. Happy to be of service. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, Dhanvat Pranams. Thanks for the Nectarian class, Prabhu. I just had one question. In the process of, you know, like being magnanimous or going over and above, you know, trying to serve others. So is there a chance of, in one sense, diluting bhakti or, you know, kind of cheapening bhakti? I mean, do you think that that may happen? And also I was hearing another class yesterday where Prabhuji gave a class and he was saying that this, the apparent behavior of Srila Nityananda Prabhu actually created some doubts even in scholars. So I was just wondering if you can help me understand that.
Yeah, of course. Is it possible that while being liberal and trying to reach out to others, there's a possibility to dilute bhakti? Yes, that danger is always there. You know, in this world, there's a danger that we can dilute bhakti. That's one danger. But there is other danger also that we can make bhakti completely so lofty that it becomes inaccessible for people. Then if Prabhupada wanted that, then why did he go to America also? He wanted to make sure that bhakti is accessible. And so Prabhupada says that realization means to present things in a way that is interesting for the audience without screwing out any unscrupulous meaning. So that both points are there. So that means while we are presenting bhakti, we present things in a way that will be relevant for the audience. But if that is all that we are doing, so for example, when we speak to new people, we may speak very basic concepts. But if we start speaking like very pre-devotional or semi-devotional kind of knowledge, even in our Bhagavatam classes, then that is a problem. If you see Srila Prabhupada, if you read the book Ishopanishad, in the entire Ishopanishad, Prabhupada hardly ever uses the word Krishna. Prabhupada uses the word Lord, God, Ishwara. Uses the word like that. He doesn't use the word Krishna. Now, why is that? You know, we have that famous example of Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur saying that, you know, he would just count how many times the word Krishna has been used in an article and he would publish that. Now that is one anecdote, and that was not the standard editorial policy. Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur was also quite strict in editorial, and he wanted the editorial content to be good. In fact, most of the times he would himself review every single article, and then he would carefully edit and publish it. So we can't take that one anecdotal example as an absolute principle. But what is Prabhupada doing in Ishopanishad? The Upanishads are what generally attract the jnani kind of people, who are often impersonalists, who are often attracted to the impersonal aspect. So Prabhupada was commenting on a book which is considered a stronghold of the Advaitins. And while he was commenting on that book, if he starts itself by talking about Krishna, the Advaitins will say that this is simply, or those who are impersonally oriented, they'll say, oh, this is simply a personalist book. And I'm not interested in this. They will reject the book. What Prabhupada does is, he talks in very broad terminology, uses deep philosophy, talks about universal principles, and then slowly but surely, he brings in personalist principles very clearly. But he doesn't use the personalist terminology. So he doesn't use Krishna over there. So is Prabhupada diluting Krishna's message? No, it's for reaching out a particular audience. Prabhupada does a particular thing. So basically, dilution can happen broadly in two main ways. One is that if we start, either the pre-devotional message or the pre-devotional practices or pre-devotional standards, pre-devotional standards, if we start teaching them even to devotees, or we start practicing them ourselves, that's how dilution happens. If for reaching out to a particular segment of people who are anyway otherwise not going to be reached out to, if we adopt a particular approach, then is that dilution? No. If that is only for that audience, and people who are anyway not going to come to a temple, who are not anyway directly going to hear about Krishna, anyway those who are not going to follow the rules of bhakti, then maybe let them take one step upwards. So why not do that? So we have that example that Prabhupada quoted Chanakya Pandit, and he said that Ekas Chandrastamo Hanti Na Chitara Sahasrasha. He said that it is one moon outshines 1,000 stars. Yes, so Prabhupada said, it's better to have one moon than 1,000 stars. Which is true. If we get one serious devotee, that's wonderful. But, sometimes in the name of looking for that one moon, we end up extinguishing 1,000 stars. No, let the stars also stay in the sky. What do I mean extinguishing 1,000 stars? That somebody who is not able to digest the higher message, somebody who is not able to digest the higher standards, we start making them feel so rejected, so guilty, so impure, that whatever little spirituality they may have, whatever little appreciation or interest in Krishna may have, that gets destroyed. So, yes, if we want, Prabhupada said his mission is successful if he has one pure devotee. But why did Prabhupada engage with the life members? Prabhupada went to the house of thousands and thousands of life members, and he took prasad at their house, inspired them in bhakti. Hardly anyone became initiated. So it is, we don't know in advance which star will become a moon. And just because a star is not becoming a moon, if we extinguish it, then we are doing violence. So sometimes the star has to be fanned so that it will become a moon. But if the star is not becoming a moon, then we just fan it, we just extinguish it. That is unhealthy. So we could say there is a a pyramid effect, we could say. If people who are living lives in the modes of passion and ignorance, if by hearing something from a devotee, they learn something and they come to goodness, that's a significant step up for them. If somebody from goodness comes towards a general appreciation of spirituality, that's also good for them. But somebody who from a general appreciation of spirituality comes to a specific appreciation of Krishna, that's wonderful. So we definitely want people to come all the way to the top of the pyramid. But those who are not ready to come all the way to the top, we don't have to kick them down. If you can't come all the way up, take one step up. So if that is all we offer, and that is what we start doing, then it's dilution. But if we are reaching out to people who are not ready to take the full journey, by offering them avenues by which they can take one step forward, then that is compassion. Does it address the question?
Yes, Prabhuji, thank you so much. I'm from Houston, Texas, and we have several outreach programs here, which devotees, like you said, in a very magnanimous mood, they try to give Krishna consciousness to everybody, there is one program particularly which we have here, and we've seen that, on a practical level, there have been, some problems, because though devotees try their best to preach and do nicely, but sometimes the mood is different than that of a Krishna conscious mood. I mean, what we normally see in a temple environment like that. So I understand it's just so tricky to tread on that territory, trying to do that kind of preaching. So I was bewildered myself. Though for whatever reasons, I mean, I'm not a great devotee or anything, just starting, but I've been in Krishna consciousness for 17 years now, but still I found it so difficult to get across to them, because I was always, this thing was on the back of my mind that, somewhere something, may not turn out as what we're expecting it to be. So yeah, I find it very tricky, Prabhuji. I mean, all glories to the great who do this.
No, I agree. It's not easy. It's not easy. It's that's why it's best at our level to focus on our practice of bhakti, to see the movement is very broad. And from the movement, we take whatever inspiration we get for our bhakti and move on. And if tomorrow Krishna gives us an important leadership position, then we can do a greater contribution. But at our level, if we have some concerns, we get the concerns addressed. But overall, we have come here to serve Krishna. We have come here to come closer to Krishna, and maybe whatever capacity we have, help others come closer to Krishna. So rather than spending our time too much in judging who is doing what, we focus on, am I moving closer to Krishna? Because in some ways, Krishna consciousness can be very, very vast, because Krishna is unlimited. So the ways in which people can reach out to Krishna can be many. And the ways in which Maya can reach out and take away people who are reaching out to Krishna are also many. So now, which is happening where, we don't know. So if something is troubling us specifically, we try to ask and clarify and get some reasonable understanding. But otherwise, there is no need to divert ourselves too much in what who is doing. We can focus on our practice of bhakti. And if we focus on that, we will find that within the Krishna consciousness movement, wherever we are, there are resources available for us to grow in our bhakti. Okay. So thank you very much for this opportunity to glorify Lord Nityananda. Shri Nityananda Prabhu ki jai. Shri Prabhupada ki jai.